Ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies, welcome to this seminar on the future of European security, the role of the EU. You might, of course, and there are questions to what role does the EU actually play when it comes to security? What role is there? I mean, the merits of the EU as a security provider traditionally has been as part of a larger package with NATO and with the US, aiming at the European peace, usually with the old quotation of keeping the Russians out, the Germans down, and the Americans in. And where the EU has played kind of the non-military role in this bargain, and with good, pretty good results. I mean, Germany is not down, but definitely anchored in the political institutions of Europe today. Great power rivalry has been managed within Europe, and the former communist countries have been integrated into a Europe, to a large extent, whole, free, and at peace. There has, however, been ambitions for a more assertive EU when it comes to military affairs. Those ambitions were closed down at an early point in 1954. And it was not until the rise of the common foreign and security policy when the EU again got some kind of military dimension with the common foreign the security and defense policy. This, however, was crisis management aimed at security missions and results outside of Europe. This year and last year, we've seen multiple suggestions about how this role can be developed. We've heard talk about the European armies, about the security compact, a defense union, etc., from different quarters of the European Union. And of course, there are different reasons for this. We have, for example, the obvious the Brexit situation, where the European Union needs to find a new momentum, new areas of cooperation, which is taking place now in this Bratislava prospect or process, ending in March next year. There is interinstitutional logic to this, for example, in the hybrid area where the European Union needs to define its own role, especially in relation to NATO. There is bureaucratic reasons for this. The EU finally has a new strategy for its common foreign and security policy, the European Union Global Strategy, and it now needs to be implemented, and one of the areas of implementation is the defense area. So that would be a bureaucratic reason for talking about defense and security again within the EU. But finally, there is good geopolitical reasons to talk security and defense in Europe today. In the former strategy, the European security strategy, talked about the aim, one of the main aims was to create a ring of, I think, well-governed states friendly to Europe. And now we have more of a ring of fire with states not always too friendly, and with rising authoritarianism and conflict in this ring surrounding the European Union. So there are multiple reasons to talk about European security and the EU's role within this. But of course, you can ask the question whether there will be some kind of walk after the talk. Will we see results this time? And I've got an excellent, small but efficient panel here today to discuss these issues. We have Constanze Stelzenmüller, who is the Robert Bosch Senior Fellow at the Brookings Institution. And we have Christian Mölling, the Senior Resident Transatlantic Fellow at the German Marshall Fund of the United States. And I would like Constanze to go first and say something about the strategic context for European security. What are the big geopolitical issues? What can we expect, especially from your transatlantic perspectives, on behalf of the United States when it comes to European security? And then we'll move over to Christian later. So please, Constanze, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Björn, for this very kind welcome. This isn't the first time that I've come to speak here. It's beginning to feel like familiar territory. And it's always a pleasure, particularly when the day is this beautiful. I'm very touched that so many of you resisted the temptation of spending the day outside under the sun. Who knows how long it may last? I understand there's going to be rain tomorrow and then snow. As Björn was saying, I've now been living in the United States for exactly 2 years, and I have another 2 years. And the Brookings Institution, which is sort of the biggest think tank in Washington, hired me because they decided they need a Germany explainer. I'm really a foreign and security policy generalist, but if somebody forces me, I can explain Germany too, at least I can try. And one of the conditions that I made at the time was, you know, I don't want to do only Germany. I want to spend a lot of time in the rest of Europe as well. And so I'm actually very grateful if I get the chance to be here. And I've just come from Riga, where they had their annual security conference. And I, in fact, try and hit different European spots throughout the year to make sure that I don't just transport German perspectives to my American colleagues and other discussion partners, but that I'm also capable of saying, you know, this is what other Europeans think and want or don't want. But I thought that it would probably be most useful for at least the start of this conversation if I give you a little bit of my impression of the transatlantic relationship as seen from the other side, as seen from Washington, because some parts of that may surprise you or not. I don't know. If I bore you, just raise your hand and I will try and I will just organically segue to another topic. I'm sure that Anke Schmitz-Felsmann will do that happily in the back row. She's already giggling, which shows you that she's perfectly willing to do that. Now, America. In Riga, the former president of Estonia, Toomas Ilves, said on a panel that I moderated that he thought the current state of transatlantic relations was best characterized as an Indian summer. Now, we know that the Indian summer comes after summer and it comes before fall and winter. And I think there is some truth to that, because I think that the long-term trends in the relationship hold a lot of stormy weather, but it's also true that from what I've seen in the last couple of years or so, and now in 2 years in Washington, the relationship has been unusually good and close and cooperative. And in fact, very rücksichtsvoll, as we say in German, from the American side towards Europe and Germany in particular, very interested in helping Europeans making it work. Now, this is not just an achievement of the Obama administration. This was a flip that happened during the Bush administration. Some of you may remember that the topic of our discussion today, CSDP, European Security and Defense Policy, was seen by the first George Bush administration as something, you know, close to satanic. I was at the time still a journalist, and whenever I ran into the American NATO ambassador, Nicholas Burns, he would say to me, you know, that this was the end to civilization as we knew it. And I tended to say, Ambassador, give it a rest, you know, I don't think it's quite that bad. But it was the Bush administration when it came in for its second term that actually changed its mind. And certainly the Obama administration has built on that and deepened it. And it has for different reasons, and I think they're important to understand because it has consequences for our own security situation and for what we can expect of America. From a Clinton administration, if that comes to pass. What we can expect from a Trump administration, I frankly can't tell you. I think that would be quite difficult to foretell. But the part of it, of course, was that Obama, although ironically had been at the head of the subcommittee of the Senate on Europe, had never been to Europe as in that function, and had in fact expressed very little interest in Europe. But he had a lot of people in his staff who had European roots, who were in fact born in Europe or who had one parent from Europe. And on the whole, with the sort of crises popping up and deepening in Europe, there was a great deal of concern in the White House. They started out thinking that they could pivot to Asia. They started out that they could leave Europeans to themselves and thinking, you know, we would take care of this and that we were now grown up and could safely, you know, take the wheels off the tricycle. As the reset failed, as Russia annexed Crimea and started wreaking havoc in eastern Ukraine, which it's still doing, as the Middle East started to get worse and worse, the Obama administration has become more concerned about Europe. Now, at the same time, it has become very clear in Washington that Europe is not quite the same Europe as America was dealing with in 1989-90, and that, in fact, we are dealing with a Europe in which there is an England that is on his way out, at least of the EU. There is a France that is very inward-looking, very worried about the next presidential elections and about the possibility of a more or less fascist candidate, at least making it into the first round, if not the second. And we also have now culture wars within Europe with a Polish-Hungarian alignment that is a lot more authoritarian, a lot more challenging to representative democracy and political pluralism than anything we have seen in Europe in a long while. All of these things are of enormous concern to this administration and to policy elites in Washington, in fact, on both sides of the political aisle. Traditional internationalist Republicans feel no different about this, feel no less concerned than do the Democrats. And there is, and I will not, it will not surprise you when I say that they have decided that the answer to this problem is called Germany. This is of some concern to people who are actually in government in Berlin, as we know, because there is an element of the German word is Überschätzung, an element of heightened expectations there that most sane policymakers in Berlin, I think most of them are sane, would say is exaggerated and puts too much of a burden on Germany, and that it needs to be explained to the Americans every day that Germany in the EU is not what the Americans are in NATO, or you, if you wanted to be unkind, you could say what used to be in NATO. In other words, we don't tell the others what to do, and when we try to do so, we usually get a lot of blowback and or fail. And so there is a strong interest in making Europe as an entity work. There is a strong there is a huge criticism of Brexit. The Americans are devastated by the British referendum. They tried very hard to prevent it, including with a speech by Obama, which possibly had blowback. In other words, which encouraged the Brexiteers rather than deterred them. But the reality is that our American friends would like us to make a success of the EU and would also like us to make a success of CSDP. The problem is that they are not sure that if anything short of outright war in Europe happens, that they will be able to be there with us or that they will want to be there with us. And I think that's the new normal that we may have to accustom ourselves to. All of us, I'm sure, have been fixated on the Trump phenomenon, on his remarks about alliances, on his remarks about feckless allies who don't pay enough and who will have to pay more, and all the other ways in which he has violated core taboos of the transatlantic relationship in the post-war period. But the reality is that Trump, exaggerated as he may be in every way, larger than life as he may be, represents a broader mood in America. And even if Trump loses this election and we have a President Clinton, Trumpism and the mood behind Trumpism will remain, and not only in the form of opposition on every front that the Republicans can imagine, but also a general mood that Europe can and should do more. And I think also a recognition that it is possibly beyond America's political or even military powers to be in several major theaters at the same time should that arise. And there is enough concern going on about what's happening in the South Pacific and in China and around China for there to be, I think, a general unwritten consensus in Washington that if anything serious happens, the priority would be in the Pacific rather than in the Atlantic. Yeah. There would have to be something extremely serious happening here. And that is not to say that they don't take the problems with Russia very seriously. They do, not least, of course, because of Russian direct interference in the American space, including in this election. But I can assure you that even when I arrived, RT, Russian television, was very visible and very present in Washington. They had posters everywhere saying, if you want a second opinion, you should go to rt.com. They've been very energetic in trying to exploit internal political divisions within America. So that's a very real concern, and not just because it's happening over here, because it's happening there as well. There is also, among people who are policymakers, a very real understanding that we Europeans are their most important democratic and their most effective political and military partners, that we are not just the staging place for their bases and their forces, but that we are also important political partners on most issues of global governance and regional governance. That sentiment remains, but there will be greater reliance on our ability to take care of ourselves. There will be a greater assumption that we should take care of smaller, minor, or even medium-sized confrontations or conflicts on our own. And I think that is what we're going to have to deal with. And this, I think, and I've been talking about this at such length, I'm going to stop shortly, but I've made such a point of this to make it clear to you that the context of European security and defense that we have been discussing for nearly two decades now has changed quite dramatically, and not just because of Russian aggression or because of the disintegration of the Middle Eastern regional order. The really serious issue is our relationship with America. And if we want that relationship to remain good and to remain functional, we need to do better at working together in Europe to resolve our own security concerns. And one thing that I want to mention is that because some countries in Europe are not members of NATO, and some countries are not members of the EU, there has been, I think, a new temptation to seek out bilateral relationships with America and to make sure that, you know, whatever one's position is, either on the EU or NATO, whether one is Norway or Sweden, in other words, or Finland, one has a good bilateral relationship with America. And I would, my final recommendation would be to not put too much weight on that, because I think that managing all these bilateral relationships in what is now a very small and integrated European geostrategic space is, for 28 countries or 27 countries, or if we're looking at all of Europe, not just EU Europe, a lot more, is even for the Americans a very difficult exercise, and one that they're getting slightly tired of. So I think that all of these developments are a new and very potent argument for getting European security and defense right politically. So not just militarily, the politics of this, I think, are what matters. And I'm going to stop now because I've finished my 15 minutes. I have some things to say about the politics of this, but I thought that the most useful thing that I could tell you today is my perception of what these changes mean for the larger geostrategic context of CSTP.
Thank you very much, Constanze, and I'm sure we will return to these issues after Christian. Christian, would you want to say something about more the inner logic? We've heard the geostrategic context of European defense and the role of the US, but what could we actually do, and what kind of political opportunities do you see of doing it right now?
Yeah, I think what I have to say fits perfect into where Constanze stopped. So I guess the question is, does Europe have understood what the US expects from us on the one hand? And even if the US wouldn't be there, have we understood what our responsibility is? So first of all, that European security is a European issue and has to be taken care of by the Europeans and not by the US. Which was, from the beginning on, from the debate of European security and defense and European security and defense identity, something that was a key question, which has been undecided. I think we don't need to decide. I think what we need to do is we basically have to take up the point that it is, as the US is not necessarily only getting weaker, but getting more involved in other areas, there is something that is left for us, and there's more left for us than it has been before. So is Europe catching up with this? If you take the language of the global strategy, of the EU's global strategy, and the first words about what is called the Security and Defense Implementation Plan, you could say, wow, yes, Europe has understood. Maybe we have misunderstood, but I'm coming to that in a moment. Language about, you know, being autonomous on action, taking responsibility, you know, having the global strategy is very much a global strategy because it tries to take a global look. Doesn't mean to be engaged globally, but to be comprehensive. So every of those words, which have been, I guess, positive and important in the discourse on security and defense over the last decades, is in the strategy. The problem that we see for the moment is that the first steps to initially implement it is so poorly prepared that we have to hope for the next steps. That's basically the problem. So what has happened after the summer break, after the global strategy has been presented, is a process that is hasted. Why? Because the people in Brussels fear 2017. 2017 is a year of big elections. It's the election in France, it's the election in Germany, and it's the forming of a government in the US still, which means a tremendous blockage to everything, which has to happen in Europe. So everybody is kind of thinking, what can we make happen before, until the end of 2016, so within the next weeks, and what can happen afterwards, so after 2018, how we basically get through 2017, and what will be the starting point after 2017. Maybe the interesting point of that. So how to skip, how to get away from all this. And that was the condition under which the European institutions started planning the implementation plan, which at the end of the day is, how would you say, it's kind of the train is leaving the stations without being the wagons, on having the hooked up the wagons, because governments have not been prepared for it. If you take a look into what governments are currently, you know, discussing, you have the rhetoric, yes, especially with Germany and France, with, you all may be aware about the letters that have been sent around, which were basically not letters, but issues in newspapers, and unfortunately, obviously not much more on planning behind it, which means it's all about trying to send out a signal on security and defense, a positive signal, especially after the Brexit, a positive signal about Europe and about European integration or cooperation, to counter the narrative that Brexit means a breakup of the Union, which I think is all good. The problem is that in this area of security and defense, Europe has a long history and a long track record of over-exaggerating its role. If you look back to 1992, it was the so-called Hour of Europe, when the Balkan Wars broke out. People said, okay, now Europe is basically to manage its own destiny. And this didn't happen. It was, again, the US we needed to sort out the mess. And this is true until recently. We had a huge so-called defense summit in 2013, which said, basically, you know, blah, 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 we have to do more defense. And we not only have to be more attractive, but we basically have to reach out and make a more secure neighborhood. 4 months later, Russia basically invaded Ukraine. And since then, European security and defense has been absent. So that's the kind of the over-exaggeration of the European role, if you want to, of the role of the European Union in all this. Behind that, now it's one sentence before, it's always easy to criticize Brussels. And that's also because Brussels and the people who are leading the institutions are over-exaggerating their role. Don't know why they do it, but it seems to be in the blood or in the DNA. So these people are over-exaggerating the role in terms of, normally you can see Brussels as a negotiation and consensus machinery. These people can't forge consensus or can't lead. Mrs. Mogherini cannot lead, Mr. Juncker cannot lead, at least not on security and defense policies. It always needs the consensus from the governments at home. And this is something which, in all this debate, is happily overlooked, also by the governments, because it's easy to blame the people they pay in Brussels to be the heads of institutions, so to be blamed by the governments. But it allows them to always run around the problem, and the problem is, especially in security and defense, especially in defense, but it's, I think it's to a certain extent the same in security. While these governments tell at home and tell among each other that they are independent, they are not. They simply don't have the capability to be independent, militarily or on the security side. So they need cooperation. If you take a look, the defense cooperation is something, you know, traditionally that has been a long time of talk. But if you see into the reaction that came out of the Paris attacks, or the Brussels attacks, or the Nice attacks, it was always about more cooperation, more information sharing, and all these languages. So there is always the recognition of the need to do more jointly. Then you always end up in a catch-22 situation, which means if you make transparent the fact that you are dependent on others, how can you say that you are independent to your people at home? So it's a kind of a t- typical dilemma the governments are in, and it ends up in a situation where governments choose the dream of autonomy and killing their security defense capabilities for the sake of being able to still say we are independent, which is strange. I mean, we are here in a country which has 30,000 soldiers. I just looked it up in military balance. I'm from a country that has 170,000 soldiers. We are all dependent on each other. We all need partners. I mean, it's pretty obvious. But still, we can't basically make it happen. So the question is, for the moment, whether Europe is able to make a new kind of step forward. And Constanze said it. I'm not sure whether it's only the Germans. I think it's the French and the Germans who would have to make the step, because everything in a smaller union, and for the moment, even if the Brits haven't physically or legally checked out, mentally they have checked out since quite a long time. Anything that can happen positively or negatively comes from Paris and Berlin. And it's not that Paris is blocked that much on security and defense, I would say. It's more that the Germans are blocked on this, because our... I'm not going to too much into domestic politics. It's the interesting development in Germany is that after the rather positive drive of that came with the Ukraine crisis, especially for defense and afterwards for security, now the election is basically overshadowing things already. So we see that compromises or the willingness of the government, set also by the two leading parties, by the Social Democrats and the Conservatives, stating their willingness to take more responsibility and also acting in this direction, is currently put on hold. We are falling back into the old traps, into the old trenches in the government, so that the initiative for more Europe and more European Union that has been in the letters over the last month is basically not happening. So the Germans are dropping out. Also in the White Book, that's true. So there's much language on especially from Berlin, on what we want to do. But currently, the courage to implement it is no longer there, because people are looking more into, okay, where will I be next year, than into the question where will Europe be next year. That's kind of driving the whole thing around. Can we solve this problem? Unfortunately, for the moment, I don't think so. I guess we have to wait after. We have to wait until the politically speaking, until the end of the election phase in Europe. But still, the new governments that will come in place will act like the old governments. So the question is, what is the striking point that can make a difference? I think the difference can be made if we basically say, instead of looking into how we would like Europe to be in the future, we look into Europe as it is today and make transparent the dependencies that we have in security and defense and take a deep look into it. Because in general, everybody knows, yeah, we need friends. But in the concrete situation of deciding on whether you build on solidarity or whether you build on autonomy, we always shift over into the autonomy. So I think the only way to make also the Germans and the French willing to go down the next steps in more Europe or more European Union is to let them have a look into what their dependencies on each other and on the other friends is. That sounds rather technical, but at the end of the day, as this is about the question of legitimacy of the state and of the government and of the electorates, it's rather political to come into a situation. And especially I think that's the case for France and for Paris, coming to a situation where you have to make compromises politically and make them transparent on your autonomy, political and military autonomy. That's a big step. But I think that's the only way how we can go forward on these topics in a positive way. I mean, there are other alternatives of which I'm not sure whether they increase our security. I'll stop here. Thanks very much.
Thank you. I'll sit down with you. We'll have plenty of room for questions for the audience. I have a few at first. I'm curious. I mean, one of the things that is expressed clearly in this new European global strategy is the ambition of autonomy, of strategic autonomy, although it's framed in a regional context. And you've both been kind of discussing this topic because it's a supply and demand thing. We had the supply of assistance from the US and the demand of different crises that needs to be fixed. But what's the scope for strategic autonomy, and what do we really need to achieve it? I mean, for example, you've written recently that, well, of course, we need political will and some kind of direction, but that is volatile stuff. I mean, it could change overnight, but capacity takes years or even decades to build up. And it sounds to you, Constanze, that even in a, I mean, Hillary might will, but we're going to live with Trumpism for a couple of years. With obvious, that would also be part of the equation in the future. So what is this concept of strategic autonomy, and how can we, to some extent, fill it?
Can I take a first stab at that and turn it the other way around? Which is that I think strategic autonomy can only be achieved anymore at European level. But we are still far away from that. What we have now is interdependence and non-autonomy for all European countries, not least, thank you, Ulva, not least because none of us can afford full spectrum forces anymore and have not been able to do that for a long time. Not even the big three, the UK, France, and Germany. And in fact, for most of us, our capabilities, our military capabilities, our intelligence capabilities, to some degree our political capabilities, our budgets, are not on the same level of as our understanding of the needs. And because there are almost no crises around us, or indeed in Europe, that are affect only one country and none of the others. Because all of these things affect us in similar ways, and because they're also larger than even the biggest European countries could hope to deal with on their own, all of these are very powerful arguments for trying to achieve, to regain autonomy, to regain control on a multilateral level. That's a really complicated argument to make if you're giving a stump speech as a parliamentarian who wants to be re-elected. That's why usually people who do your defense and security in parliaments have a hard time getting re-elected. This stuff is technical, it's abstract, and it's hard to understand. But I assure you, for those of us who watch this space very carefully, it is very real and very concerning. And unfortunately, it has to be said, the Brits have, I think, drawn the opposite conclusion, which is that the only way that they can regain autonomy and control is through leaving the European Union. And I think that they are going to have a very bad time with this. I have a lot of friends in Britain, not just in the security and defense community, but others as well. And so far, I think the what's called regret is getting greater by the day. I think only very few people would still defend this decision, but most people think that they're going to go through with it and that there is in fact going to be a hard Brexit. So, in other words, strategic autonomy, I think, is something that is no longer to be had at the individual national level, even for big European countries. I think the only way to regain it is by cooperating, and perhaps by cooperating in ways that we haven't even thought of yet, that we haven't even tried of before. And I can also assure you, that's what I was trying to say earlier, that this is what our American friends, who you know, look at what we have and what we can do and what we can't do in a very dispassionate sort of way, but at the same time are very care deeply about whether we manage to do this or not. I think our American friends would be delighted if we just got onto it and did it. It's my general impression.
I was just thinking about in Germany you have where we call it Eigenleben. Is there an English translation for it?
Depends on the context.
Yeah, because this
life of its own.
I'll try to explain this. On the autonomy, I'll give two explanations. One is a very technical, nitty gritty one. Which is about life on its own. The term autonomy was picked up when Juncker said it in his speech. Interestingly, it came in there from people who were basically doing defense industry. And the term comes from the defense industrial world. So it was, from my point of view, it simply was basically totally over-exaggerated. But it, I mean, people felt great about it. So it was obviously there is an interest to talk about autonomy. Great. But as I said, I think it's completely over-exaggerated. But it's, from a discourse point of view, interesting to see how things basically get completely out of control. The second answer is a rather academic one. I think this term autonomy is completely, because we can't achieve it, it's completely useless. And second, it's also useless because it tries to picture as autonomy would be possible in an interdependent world. And there, basically, I would go back to power and interdependence. It's much more about managing our interdependencies among each other and with the rest of the world than trying to be autonomous. I would even argue that we don't want to be autonomous. Because independent of the US? No, we want the US to be engaged.
So what you're really saying is this in the same way as the term European army is misleading. It's a misleading term because it creates wrong expectations.
Yeah, expectations you can't meet from the capability point of view. You can't fulfill, and politically, so you don't have the resources to fulfill it, and politically, you may not interested to be. Because how would a world look like in that Europe is independent or autonomous of the US, being a possibly even a competitor of the US in security and defense? I'm not sure this is a more peaceful world we would look into. So this is something I would say it's much more complicated in thinking about, you know, managing interdependencies, because it means immediately you have to take the other on board. Autonomy also means your environment doesn't matter. Yeah. It seems to be a great metaphor, but sorry, this is not true. I mean, you can dream of that. That's nice. After some red wine.
Can I then correct my own explanation and say, Christian's right, and I didn't want to create the impression that I think that strategic autonomy per se, as in, you know, Europe protecting itself from the negative influences of crises in the world, is possible or desirable. That's not what I mean, and I don't think that is what the European Global Strategy means when it uses the term. That's but true, I think you make a really important point when you say it's possible to misunderstand it that way. I think what it's supposed to mean, sort of like the also misguided term European army, is that we are no longer capable of addressing most of these things on our own, and if we want to figure out a way of handling them, we have to figure out how to act together better, and because we all have partial capabilities, that's a powerful argument for throwing them together. Yeah, that's the sort of hard, you know, the value of the term autonomy.
Yeah, I guess that's it. Sure. And I guess, as you mentioned, the Brexit, I mean, it's the best example that you can have, that being autonomous and being alone basically means you're weak. Yeah. And how can you be autonomous if you're weak? Mm. I mean, it simply doesn't work together. So it's more about the level of what you can decide and where you can take real control over your own destiny. Than really talking about something which is absolute on that term. So this is something
But isn't it very often implied, even in the wording, that this autonomy is pretty restricted? I mean, we political scientists talk about bounded generalizations when we don't want to be too brave, and perhaps this is bounded autonomy. It's not really a full-scale autonomy. It's really way beyond the Article 5 threshold. It's in our absolute region, small issues. That's where we're going to find our autonomy.
Well, I think what autonomy means in this context is we can't rely on the Americans all the time as we used to. We can't do free riding the way we used to. So we have to do more together and on our own if we want to solve any of the problems that we used to just hand on to the Americans. Yeah. It's that simple.
I mean, you can play it also the other way around. A European autonomy also has to accept European autonomy has to accept that there is no national autonomy. It builds basically on the fact. And this is a problem for most of the governments to say, okay, it's not, first of all, government has to be autonomous, and for the rest, so to say, what is above 100% can be given to the European Union. So it's a kind of a nice give in. That's not the point, but that's nothing we have arrived, I guess. And there, the interesting thing in the discourse that I sense here is that at that point, people like to talk about autonomy because it sounds strong. You know, Europe is strong. And then for the moment, obviously we are able to kind of live in parallel worlds then and say, yes, Europe is strong and the nation state is strong and everybody is strong. So it's kind of, you know, you can have the butter and the money for the butter, which is not the reality. You have to basically come back and say there is a real need to why we need to cooperate. And cooperation is, of course, it's a painful thing. I mean, if you want to have a consensus among 28, this is a painful work you always have to do. But that's a good reason why we have to do it.
No point of it not being possible to have the money for the butter and the butter. You will remember the Boris Johnson's famous quote about when he said, "I am pro having my cake and eating it." That's not a choice we have anymore in Europe, and that's what this is about, really. It's about making the right choices. So that we don't end up having no choice at all.
Talking about the UK's cake and who will eat it, what is your take on the UK in the broader sense of European security in the future? Do you think we're going to see more of an investment in NATO? I mean, the UK has been part of this package of European security with the EU, the transatlantic link, NATO, and now they're opting out of one aspect of it. How will it affect others? And
I mean, my take is always try to shock people and say there is no effect. If you take an isolated view on security and defense, the dropout of the UK out of the EU means nothing. Why? Because of the dropout, the UK is not losing capabilities. So therefore, and we can find arrangements in which the UK can be still part of whatever kind of EU operation, mission, whatever. So that's in principle, that's not a big thing. And the same is true for the security arrangements, most of them at least, where the UK can still be in the loop. So this is the only thing that changes is kind of the institutional boundary. But at the end of the day, if we talk about especially military capabilities, these capabilities are neither owned by the European Union nor by NATO. They are owned by the member states. And therefore, UK capabilities are owned by the UK. And they can, of course, decide where they put them.
Can I disagree with that? That's one point, I think, where you and I sort of were probably are on different ends of this. Some of you may remember that in the after the Bosnia War, the genocide in Bosnia, and the Kosovo Air War in 1998-99, it was the Brits who pushed CSDP through the St. Malo summit and the European headline goals. This is a British project and a British idea where the Brits, for the first time and sadly for the last time, trying to take the lead in European defense, both intellectually and practically. This is what led to the European battle groups, who are now, you know, have been in existence for over a decade, but who haven't been used, and where, you know, in parentheses, we may have to have a serious discussion among Europeans about whether this is still a useful concept or whether this needs to be reconsidered fundamentally. That's one thing. The other thing is that I think the political signal of Britain leaving the EU is devastating. Yeah? It's an expression of disbelief in the European project from a country that contributed two significant things to Europe. A very liberal and globalized outlook on free trade, and we're now having some free trade debates both in the United States and in Germany, that are, if anything, suggest that the winds are going in the direction of trade protectionism. For a country like ours that derives its prosperity from trade, not just with Europe, but with the rest of the world, that's a really alarming development. But to have 100,000 people demonstrate in the streets of Berlin alone against TTIP suggests that some of our fellow citizens don't understand where their national income comes from. I mean, to put it very brutally. Yeah. This is one advantage of having the Brits in the EU. The other advantage was, of course, their sort of very, you know, muscular attitude to hard power, which I personally always thought was a somewhat useful counter to, you know, German sort of carrot-eating pacifism. if you'll forgive me putting it this way. It's you know, you sometimes need to have a counterpart, a friend, who will tell you, you know, your attitudes aren't entirely useful. Now, I'm not a warmonger. Yeah, I'm not a bellicist, as Germans would say. But I do think that there are cases where where it was very helpful to have the Brits in the room. And if the Brits are no longer in the EU, we will have to have some sort of informal arrangement with them where we talk about these security and defense matters. But it will, I assure you that it will be made more difficult, yeah, by this, because of the cloud of Brexit. Yeah, because Brexit, of course, is an expression, as far as I'm concerned at least, expression of a lack of confidence in the European project at a time when that project is being questioned by the Russians very aggressively, when it's being questioned by the Hungarians, and when even a Polish president is saying, well, you know, or a Polish foreign minister is saying, you're all, bicycling vegetarians. And that's not the kind of Europe we want. We want a Europe that's much more identitarian, yeah, and less pluralist and sort of, you know, happy-clappy. And that, in other words, it just, the British exit contributes to a sense that we no longer have a sense of cultural and values cohesion and consensus that I find deeply worrying. So, I mean, you know, you're right that we didn't have, we have almost no shared assets in Europe in sort of technical terms, but I think this technical aspect is much less important than the political signaling that comes out of this crisis.
Thank you. Please raise your hands if you have questions, and it's soon time. One last question for me before I let go here. When you're talking about the European project, and you've been also discussing this narrative of Europe, in relation to Brexit, I mean, to what extent could foreign policy, or more specifically security policy, be one of the kind of engines of integration in the future? I mean, we see the we don't have a lot of alternatives. The taking care of the migration situation is not really one. And Eurozone is not really happening anytime soon.
Very sad that the Swedes are not joining the Euro.
Well, 13% of the Swedes, I think, would agree with
you. Yes, I know.
last time I checked. But what's the prospect for security and defense to be the new kind of engine of integration, or at least the backbone of a new narrative?
As pessimistic about this as about everything else?
No, it would be as realistic as always. I mean, going back to the beautiful work that has been done on security and securitization, you would need to make Europe a point of reference of your security concerns. And that's something I currently hardly see, that we would make the European Commission, the European Parliament, and the European Council as the points of reference of security, you know, Europe as a whole. And it's unfortunate, but I think the migration and refugee crisis has taught us quite a lesson on that, as to what extent we feel the same threat to the same point of reference here. So I'm rather pessimistic. I think the reason, going back to going back to the Franco-German letters from summer this year, the reason why security and defense featured so high in there was that there are many other areas where we weren't able to find any consensus. So, I mean, in economic policy, in fiscal policies, the French and the Germans are kind of, you know, on two different planets. So the only areas where security, defense, and youth unemployment and I think
borders.
Borders, yeah. So that's the consensus that we are able to reach so far. So if you take it from that point of view, I think I wouldn't fall in the same trap as many of us have fallen in over the last years, that security and defense could be a driver, really kind of building identity around it. Would be interesting. It would be great. But I think there we find ourselves in a bubble if we think about that this is could be a reality rather soon.
Okay, just for the heck of it, I'm going to disagree again. Here's how, this is also for the sake of, you know, having sort of, you know, piquing your interest. I think there's two things that drive security, the Europeanization of security and defense these days. One is One is real, one is possible. The possible one is war at our borders. You know, we already have that in a sense in Ukraine, but it's just below the level of something of what we had in Yugoslavia, say. I am quite able to imagine the Ukrainian violence, the conflict there, escalating to a degree where we suddenly start talking about a humanitarian crisis or no-fly zones the way we did in Bosnia, and which is what got us into Bosnia in the first place. And I think that the only reason why that isn't happening is that the Russians are very carefully keeping it below that level, so that we don't get engaged in this way. In other words, they're frustrating us without provoking us so much that we want to get involved. But it's not unimaginable that this could escalate, and because it spirals out of control. And the experience of the past, and I was a reporter during the Yugoslav war, that experience showed that that is a moment when Europe actually does spring into action, and when suddenly things become possible that previously you couldn't even discuss or think about. I think that's a very high price to pay, particularly for the war zone itself. I think that the other area, which is currently provoking some kind of defense and security integration, which is very practical, is actually two things. One is border security, and the other thing is intelligence and counterterrorism. Yeah? We may be unable to agree on a Europeanization of migration policy, but the pressures, the de facto pressures to cooperate on both intelligence and counterterrorism on the one hand, on border security on the other, are very high and very real. And so I think the informal degree of sort of bottoms-up cooperation and joint learning that's happening in those fields is very real. And I can also imagine there coming a sort of a tipping point where you say, you know, we've already gotten this far on this. I mean, this is how armies change. You know? Armies are never reformed from the top down. Armies change because they encounter challenges in the field, as it were, that make the company commanders, you know, and the battalion commanders change the way they do things, and then that is handed up. And I suspect that's what's happening now in these two fields. We've already seen it happening post 9/11. But these things, you know, are very rarely sort of then poured into a grand European policy. But if you actually watch the changes that are happening in the way that people work together, they're really significant. Yeah. This is very different from what this landscape was 10 or 15 years ago. And things are now possible and are being done that weren't possible and that weren't being done 10 or 15 years ago. You know, and they are, so I think it's important not always to look just at the European documents, but you have to look at European practice. And at some point, I think then describing the European practice will change our mind about how Europe actually works. So, I mean, that's not a fundamental disagreement with you. It's just saying, you know, there are other levels of change in Europe which are quite real and I think have a significant impact, even if it's one that we don't directly see in our lives. Mm.
Lars-Erik Lundin, you had the mic is coming your way.
I think I can speak.
No.
Oh, take the mic.
Oh, Kai, thank you. when you mention security and defense, people here in Sweden would say, well, that's either for Sweden or it's for NATO. Mm. I think most people in this room would not see that this is an issue about the EU. But what surprised me traveling to London and Paris in the last weeks was that is a view which is not shared by many very serious security policy analysts. They're not necessarily talking about the EU, but they're talking about Europe. And they are not necessarily talking about the CSDP. They are talking about what you just mentioned, the nexus between internal and external security, and more precisely, the threat that terrorism poses for the military today and makes it almost impossible, for instance, in France, to do the job properly without taking terrorism fully into account, internally and externally. So, and then everyone is also worried, of course, about resources and what you mentioned about Trumpism, the fact that the 2% requirement will be pushed much harder, probably next year, whoever is the president. So you have Schäuble with the defense budget idea, which we don't know what that actually is. So in short, the Brits, what I hear, there are many Brits now who say, we need a new format, which is not EU, but Europe. We need a new arrangement, so to say, which is not NATO, but can you imagine such an arrangement? Which is a sort of not, which doesn't put the UK after Brexit in a
isolated position.
As a, yeah, as a, like a Turkey, you know, who will be invited from time to time to Brussels, but who actually is part of a new European integrated arrangement. Because that is what people are talking about.
Do you want to collect, or should we respond directly?
Do we have another question there?
Well, my question is rather the mentality of Europe and Europeans. There is another saying you mentioned about butter. You have to choose between butter and guns. And I guess the Europeans always choose butter. I mean, we speak about 2% commitment on BNP for defense. In Sweden, we have 1%. And that's not, no one talking about increasing that. We will join NATO, but we will not increase our defense budget. So, but the basic question is, have the Europeans a mentality to increase their defense efforts, even despite you have to use less butter? Thank you.
I think the answer to that's pretty simple. If you look at the Wales and Warsaw NATO commitments, it's most European member states in NATO have decided to increase their defense budgets quite significantly. And I actually think that German defense efforts are very real. I mean, you can say that a lot of this will take place in the future and we have a significant federal election between now and then. But for the German defense minister to say, you know, we're going to increase personnel, we're going to reform the Bundeswehr, the German finance minister, Schäuble, to say, and yes, we're going to increase the budget. And Merkel, just a few weeks ago, reinforced that message and said at a Christian Conservative Democratic Party youth organization conference, we will have to achieve that 2% promise that we made in NATO. That's serious, and we have to do this. I mean, that would actually mean a huge German defense budget. That would be practically doubling it, which I don't think is an option currently. But to even say that so publicly, to make such a public commitment for the Chancellor, is a very unusual thing, and she will be held to it, and she will be measured by it. And that's and the other remarkable thing is that you don't have a German public outcry because of that. I think there is a feeling across Europe that we need to look to our defenses because of what's happening in Eastern Europe and in the South, that we need to invest more, and that what we have isn't good enough, and that we can't always rely on the Americans, yeah, even if we want them to be our partners. Oh. And that to me is, you know, you may say, Christian might say, you know, it hasn't happened yet. The money needs to be put into certain things. But as far as I'm concerned, the political impact of these, you know, signing these public documents and making these public declarations is pretty massive. And if you have what seems to me like widespread public agreement with this, that's already a fairly remarkable shift of a kind that we haven't seen in a very long time. So I'm less worried, frankly. Now, as on your second question of what to do with the Brits, I mean, I think, you know, that the, I don't think we're not going to have a third formal arrangement next to the EU and NATO. That's not going to happen. If anything, I think these things are going to start converging more and more as we work more together, because the NATO knows that the EU has capabilities and tools that NATO doesn't have and doesn't want to acquire. Yeah? And I think that we will all be creative and pragmatic in acquiring, in just working informally with the Brits. Let me give you a practical example. The Iran negotiations are a significant example of a very high-level European involvement in a key dossier that the Americans could have said, we're keeping you out of because it's too important. Yeah. And it was five nuclear states, yeah, and one non-nuclear state, Germany. Yeah. Three European states, yeah, and the Americans and the Russians, and was the sixth one? I'm blanking. The Chinese? Anyway, whatever. What I mean to say is that when it's necessary and when circumstances require it, we are perfectly capable of finding informal temporary formats, you know, that the rest of Europe or the rest of NATO is happy delegating to because they themselves don't have the political bandwidth to be a part of that, but are happy to be consulted or informed. You know, and that's the way these things work. I'm not worried about the Brits being left out in the cold, at least on practical matters. What do you think?
I think what matters more for the question of whatever format can be there to get the Brits on board is the situation in which we will find ourselves when the Brexit negotiations really start. Mm. Because I think what we currently see, and what I got from London is because of the domestic dynamics and the kind of the spiraling arguments within the Conservative Party driving themselves into a hard Brexit and talking themselves into a hard Brexit, and the reaction from the European side and say, okay, if you want to go, then go, but leave the keys on the table. You know, it's like, yeah, it's if you break up a relationship like this, it's over. And especially if you use the rhetoric as it's currently coming out of London. It's very undiplomatic, and I know that the people in the FCO are, you know, looking for new jobs to a certain extent, because this is, you know, it's all domestic politics for the moment. But at the end of the day, this will be the climate in which, what? The Brits say, you need us? And the Europeans have said the day before, no, we don't need you? I mean, how do you climb down from all the trees you basically put yourselves up there?
Yeah.
This is the most worrying thing. So what I've said about Brexit and defense is, of course, technical. And what I worry most about it, that's the distinction I would always make, is the political climate has nothing to do with security defense, but is spilling over into everything now. And it is poisoning the situation with the Brits. So whatever kind of rationale decisions and discussions we may have about a necessary institutional arrangement has to take into account what the political climate will be at that point. I think it will not be a honeymoon thingy. It will be more like, you know, if you get into a divorce, how you regulate the rest of the things that you have to regulate. I follow your remarks on defense budget and so on and so on, up to the point where we say that this alone is a tremendous message. No, I disagree on that point. Why? Because this is no longer the time just after the end of the Cold War where it doesn't matter whether you put basically deeds to the words.
Sure.
We are watched cautiously. What Europe is doing is watched cautiously by the Americans, by the Russians, and by the Chinese. And they will use the opportunity to call the bluff that is in the papers in the most unpleasant moment. And so, this is something you can do when the world is either dumb or cooperative, or both. But the world is no longer this way. There are no cooperative, or very many, many non-cooperative people out there, or actors out there. So I would say it's the other way around. If we don't put the beef to the bones, this is something that will fall on
our cold. Yeah.
Yeah, this will fall on our feet. Yeah. Because simply because you can, it's such an easy story you can tell. Europe has always failed on this, you know, making big statements. There was even the idea to have a 2% formula now within the European Union. It's all cheap talk. And this is the big risk in Europe for the moment. So even if our defense, if our Minister of Finance talks about this, let's see. At the end of the day, for the moment, what counts is what you can put on the table. And if this only is pages, then I guess our friends in the East will not be very impressed.
Do we have more questions up there?
Here we go, Constanze.
It seems like the underlying axiom for all this discussion and also this paper put out by the European Union, I mean this security paper, this one, the underlying axiom there seems to be the Wolfowitz doctrine, which says that after the Cold War, it should be an unipolar world. And this is what is creating the tensions that we have now. I think that is what should be the discussion points, because the case is that Russia, India and China do not want to live in an unipolar world. They won't have to have some saying about the development, which is not strange, but you see what the so-called unipolar world has created, especially in the Middle East just now. You cannot blame China, India or Russia for the mess in the Middle East. This was only created by leading nations of NATO, and foremost the mass murder sitting in the White House just now, because every Tuesday he sits there and decides who shall die and who shall live. And this creates the tension. And this is the problem that should be discussed when you discuss European security. How shall you cooperate with the rest of the world, or shall you end up in a financial crisis disaster that is going on just right now?
Okay. Do you want to take another one?
Do you have more questions on this side? Any pick on the unipolar moment? Is the BRICS just kicking back?
Honestly, I think the unipolar moment was over several years ago. And I think that if we're now in, you could call it multipolarity, you could probably call it non-polarity. You could argue we are now seeing the results of an American overextension and an American and American war weariness at home. As you were probably not surprised to hear me say that I fundamentally take issue with your comments about the mass murderer in the White House, who makes decisions every Tuesday. I think that's just flat out wrong. You may disagree with me, but that's now not how American foreign policy is made. You can certainly criticize Obama for his emphasis on long distance warfare, on, in other words, using special forces and using drones for U.S. military purposes. Those have had consequences that are being hotly debated in American security circles and have been criticized, of course, both in those same security circles and in the wider American public. But the truth is, the truth is that the aggressors here are other people. They are the Russians, they're Assad, and a bunch of other people that I could think of. China is pursuing a very reckless policy in its own neighborhood, and that a number of nations in South Asia are now asking the Americans, and indeed us, for a greater presence there and greater protection. Mr. Duterte, I think, is an exception. Mr. Duterte is a somewhat unusual character. But I have a friend in Washington who is the correspondent of a major European newspaper there, who once interviewed him when he was a very young lieutenant colonel, and who bragged to him on the record about how many people he had killed, dissidents, Filipino dissidents that he had killed by throwing them out of a helicopter. So Mr. Duterte has form, as they say. He's well known to people who've known him longer. And his current behavior is no surprise to those who knew him 10 or 20 years ago. I don't think we're entitled to blame the Americans for that.
That, I guess, is true. It's a unipolar moment because it's a moment. So it means that basically,
the moment is over.
This moment is over. And I mean, the dilemma is on these things, too much US presence is a bad thing. Not enough US presence always. Obviously also a bad thing, at least if you don't kind of organize the what is filling the vacuum. Are we willing to fill the vacuum? Is Sweden willing to fill the vacuum or live with the consequences? And if you take a look into the South China Sea for the moment, nobody's willing to live with the consequences of less US presence in there. I'm not sure whether if we go through the interdependencies of Sweden and to the rest of the world, this is true at the end of the day. Because are you autonomous in this country? I guess you are not. So, I mean, I guess you are as dependent, or in this, to the same degree dependent as Germany is on what is happening in the rest of the world. So, I mean, my country is trying to take a holiday from that, what is happening in Asia. So we kind of, you know, our range goes about 3 to 4,000 kilometers around us, hopefully not touching onto Saudi Arabia, dirty issues like this, which are still part of our responsibility in there. So I think there is, we shouldn't be too selective in how we take a look into the world, because it has a tendency to fire back on us due to all the things we are in there. I wanted to come back on one thing, on the comment on Sweden and NATO. And I'm wondering why Sweden as an EU member doesn't think more actively of the opportunities that the European Union gives it to get closer to NATO and to kind of copy-paste NATO into the European Union, as you can't be member of NATO, or possibly you don't want to be member of NATO, but still, obviously, what NATO is offering is to a certain extent attractive. This can be achieved through the European Union, be it through the institutional mechanisms, be it through the capability mechanisms, all these things. So this is kind of interesting, thinking on the one hand to say it's Sweden or it's NATO, the one thing that is not sufficient, so Sweden alone, or the one thing that cannot be achieved, NATO. So why do you put yourself into such a corner? I mean, this is kind of setting yourself up for a mess. That would be at least my analysis. I would say I would copy-paste NATO procedures immediately and put them into the European Union, ensuring that if things go wrong in this area, in this geographical area, we can have as fast as possible arrangements on the political level, because the technical arrangements are in place. But that's, I mean, just a German comment.
Thank you.
And who wants German advice here, right?
Yeah, that's nobody, of course.
I'm surprised you're even here.
Okay. Thank you. With my background, I'm tempted to answer your question, Mr. Mölling, but I'm not going to try to answer that. Actually, I want to benefit from Stelzenmüller's presence and ask, in a sense, about the Steinmeier initiative, so-called, and the OSCE. Mm. When we talk about Europe and European security and so on, and you have what I would call limited to one part, but of course it's broader than we have so far discussed. And how do you look upon specifically the question of arms control and questions of dialogue and consultations, consultations, sure. But more specifically on the initiative, but also generally, how does EU security, CSTP fit into the OSCE spectrum in your view? Hmm.
Well, how do I put this? I think that I know that there was a fair amount of discussion a year ago within the German Foreign Ministry of whether it was a good idea for Germany to take on the OSCE chair at a time when there was an armed conflict going on in Ukraine. And there was, shall we say, some disagreement. And there were some people who advised the minister to not do this. And the minister said, I'm the one who makes the decisions, and jetzt erst recht, wir schaffen das, I suppose. And I think a lot of people sighed and said, okay, minister, we'll do this. But the people who organized, and this may be a little bit technical for some of you, but for the Germans and presumably for Swedes as well, who have invested over decades in arms control and disarmament. I mean, you have CPRI here, Swedes have, and Nordics in general, have always taken the lead intellectually and practically in arms control and disarmament measures throughout the Cold War. And I would say you have a significant national interest in that being part of the security conversation in Europe, in the transatlantic relationship, and with the Russians at all times. And that's, I think, a national interest that Germans and Swedes share. And so I think the German traditional reflex was, you know, this is not something we should avoid or evade. This is, if this is being put before us, we should take this up because it also matches with our willingness to take on greater responsibility. You know, who if not we, as it were. And there are, of course, as you know, some nations within the EU who are sort of significantly more inclined to give Russian interests greater traction on matters of arms control and disarmament. And the Russians have been working quite hard within the OSCE to make friends, right? And to make their views known to some of the perhaps more vulnerable members of the OSCE. So I think that was part of the motivation. But at the same time, if you look, and again, I'm being somewhat technical and detailed here, but it maybe gives you a little bit of sort of depth to the picture that we've been drawing. The goals that the German OSCE Chair Task Force drew up, I think, were very, very much not pie in the sky. You know, let's all save the OSCE and all we'll save the relationship with Russia and we'll save arms control. If anything, I suspect that the Swedish security establishment and the German security establishment share a deeply pessimistic assessment of what today is possible in terms of arms control, much less disarmament, together with the Russians. Yeah. I think the framing, if you want to frame the great European security question these days, you'll say, well, not a lot is possible with the Russians. The question is, what is possible without them? So you have to sort of figure out a way of keeping, while you have sanctions, while you have a conflict going on that you disapprove of, while you have an annexation of Crimea that you say is illegal, of having lines of dialogue open for the Russians to use should they want to. I would also add a maybe slightly more cynical take on this, which is that if the Russians make an overt choice to not use them, that also tells us something. That then, I think, tells us that our options are narrow in certain ways that is maybe also useful to know. Yeah. I think that's, in general, a thinking that plays a role in the Germans saying, no, we won't shut down the NATO-Russia Council. No, we won't shut down dialogue in general, because if we keep that as an offer and the Russians don't use it, that's a message too. Yeah. And if they do use it, that's good. In other words, it's win-win. Yeah. That's something I also tell my American friends in Washington. Yeah, that you shouldn't, you know, you shouldn't always think, you know, that the Germans are trying to throw everything overboard and make friends. In fact, those of you who go to Berlin know that there is a great deal of anger and concern about Russian behavior. So that's I think my take on the OSCE. The reality, of course, is that the chair, we're now on the last day of October. We've got two more months to go. I think that the carefully, soberly worded low expectations that the Germans expressed at the beginning of their year have, if anything, been under exceeded, if that word exists. Of course it doesn't. But you know what I mean. It's, in other words, not a great deal has happened, but at least nothing much worse has happened, except, of course, in another theater, which is Syria. Yeah. So, honestly, the problem of arms control and disarmament is currently, you know, you have to see it in a context of a Russia where the political dysfunctionality and economic dysfunctionality is becoming a matter of concern to all of Europe, to the Americans, even to Russian partners, and I think I think not so secretly to a lot of members of the Russian power elites. Yeah. And so the bigger question is, what happens to the stability of Russian power? And what consequences does that have for Russian foreign and security policy? I wish we didn't have those questions and could focus on traditional arms control questions. I wish it were that way, but I don't think that's where we're heading. So on that, that's not a very cheerful note. I admit that. But I think I would be very surprised if any of you had a much more optimistic take. Do you?
On the arms control.
I would start from a different point. I mean, arms control is not a crisis management mechanism, or you would over-exaggerate the ambitions of arms control. And I think what you said is absolutely right. It's an instrument that is not there to control arms, but it's there to control strategy, to try to inform and allow others to inform you what you would like to do, to, first of all, prevent war in the future and not the current war. This is something where arms control, I mean, trying with arms control to stop the Ukraine war or something like this, or, you know, get it under control is simply a stupid idea. I think it's a good thing to start it again and to keep the dialogue going if it is possible. But this is something which is basically up for a decade. If you take a look into the evolution of arms control, I mean, the first talk about mutual balanced force reductions, which then ended up in the CFE treaty, this has taken, I don't know how many decades, how many years. So this is something we have to look into. And this is the work of diplomats, not of think tankers, I mean, and not of politicians. This is something which basically takes very long time, very, very silent work that needs to be done. And unfortunately, it was a bit over-exaggerated. And of course, I think that that's something which the Germans have not been very good in communicating. It has caught many of our allies on the wrong foot. So they were kind of very surprised on this message coming out of it. And this has not contributed to a signal of unity on the NATO side, which is a necessary, which is the forum in which you, of course, discuss conventional arms controls, especially.
Constanze, one of the things you were talking about with Russia and OCD and the way they kind of made friends with the more vulnerable countries, I mean, that is something that we see also within the European Union. And I wonder, is there a way around this? I mean, the European Union as a common foreign and security policy has a vulnerability in the sense that we can make common policies, but the subunits, the member states, are still free to actually work against those policies and have other policies in the same area, or at least in other areas, say energy, for example. And that, of course, invites other countries, now specifically Russia, they will have more of an incentive to actually make friends within the subunits, the member states.
China.
Trojan horses.
China's very good
yes,
at this. Yeah.
China as well.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we have a systemic problem here. I mean, usually in the case of the US, they cannot only at the federal level make foreign policy, they can also stop in their system the subunits to make their own foreign policy. But we can't do that in Europe.
Right.
Is there a way around that?
Well, I would say, you know, it's not in the cards for Europe to go the way of the United States. In other words, to become a United States of Europe. Yeah, there's too much cultural, linguistic, economic, political difference for that to happen. So for the foreseeable future, we have to live with this sort of odd tension between the powers of the EU and the powers of the nation state in Europe, which are different than what you have in the United States. So yes, we will, for the foreseeable future, have a situation where it's possible for outside powers like the Chinese or like the Russians to try and split us by sort of, you know, investing, shall I say, in certain countries and in different ways. But I think you can also point to cases where those efforts have not been successful, because there has been a realization in Europe among the nation states that it is in their interest to not let that happen, and that in fact it is in their interest to have a common united European front. Again, the Iran negotiations were such a case, and one of the reasons why you had a united front together with the Americans was that everybody was worried about a preemptive Israeli strike. In other words, there was a real worry that this would go bad very quickly, with a massive impact on stability in the Middle East if we didn't find a negotiated solution. And as a result, you saw sort of one of the most successful, disciplined diplomatic solutions of recent times that anybody can remember, where the six countries involved worked extremely closely together, made very sure that there wasn't a ray of light between them, and that the rest of Europe was, and the rest of NATO was on board. Yeah. So these things can happen, but very often, you know, it does require a sort of very large challenge. Another case that I can think of is sanctions against Russia over Crimea and Ukraine. Interestingly, you know, the Germans are the ones holding together the sanctions policy, but the reality is we're much less vulnerable than some of the smaller Eastern Europeans who get 100% of their energy from Russia and who therefore arguably could say, you know, this hurts us more than you, Germany. Yeah? But they're still doing it because there is a larger question at stake. Certainly for the Estonians, the Lithuanians, the Latvians, the Poles, there is something larger at stake than energy here. It's both principles and geostrategy. Yeah? And the future of the European project. So I think, in other words, I wouldn't say that because we don't have a United States of Europe that this project can't work. Actually, we've shown that when the issue is important enough, it does. So I'm a little less concerned. It's just that I would frankly be quite happy with a couple of boring years. In other words, I would be quite happy with if we had the luxury of not having to be heroic about something all the time, but had some sort of boring issues like common agricultural policy to fight about. I mean, those were really the days, I think. That was a fabulous thing to have to be concerned about.
No, I fully agree. I don't want to add on that. I fully agree. I'm just thinking about...
So long live the common agricultural policy.
French wine, we may have made possible all that, yes. And French cheese. So, yeah.
Yeah, or butter mountains and milk lakes. Remember those days.
Yeah. Excellent. I have a final question for you, and it's about flexibility. Flexibility is something of a flavor of the month in wider discussions about where the European Union... what direction the European Union will evolve in. We're about flexible integration, even flexible solidarity has been suggested. At the same time, flexibility always happens at the expense of cohesion, apparently, because you couldn't get everyone on board. This is problematic in some policy areas, but I would guess it's even more problematic when it comes to security and possibly defense. So how much flexibility can we really sustain when it comes to defense issues? I mean, especially since one of the kind of arguments for Europeans to get their act together and start this whole project was that they were afraid of this coalition of the willings. And now we're moving towards the coalition, a European coalition of the willing system when it comes to security and defense. So is that viable or is it a risk?
I guess it comes back to what I've mentioned before. The flexibility is the point where you want to be independent. That's where the flexibility comes from. But if you take a look into the reality is that we are since 25 years operating jointly among the Europeans because we can't do it independently. I mean, even the biggest military power, the French, yes, they can start a military operation like Mali in 2013, but after 2 weeks they basically have to ring up London and Berlin and ask for logistical support because they can't sustain it. So European cooperation is kind of taking place anyway in the operational part. The bigger question, if the great bunches of defense budget increases don't come, is do we have to go for even more inflexibility? So if you want to have a military option at hand, do you maybe have to organize yourself even before to have this military opportunity at hand? I mean, just to give you an example, the Germans can no longer go abroad without the Hungarians because we are dependent on the Hungarians for medical support. So whatever we want to do, we have to call the Hungarians and say, could you come with us? Nobody talks about this, but that's the truth. That's currently, that's how it is. So flexibility, it's nice to have, and we see, you know, it's always good to talk about, but at the end of the day, the question is whether you can still afford it. If you take it on the political level, I think that what we will see for the next 5 to 10 years is what I call the German blossom, where Germany, through its bi and trilateral relationships, more and more gets governments and armed forces involved in cooperation, building up more and more a kind of a backbone, or offering a backbone, possibly with some others, where other countries and other regions are dropping out. So the French, especially, if they don't turn around in their political philosophy about military operations, they will basically be alone and be weaker than they are right now. And the Germans may be the ones who are not, as a nation, but as a partner, be strengthened by their partners and strengthen their partners. Doesn't mean that this becomes more operational, but at least we may be the ones who keep up the ability to operate militarily. And that's there you will see, this is kind of the bottom-up picture of differentiated integration. So some may integrate more because they have to, otherwise they are militarily irrelevant. And otherwise, and other countries may still be big enough to refrain from this more integration or more cooperation. Wouldn't call it integration, more cooperation. And there we may have not flexibility, but differentiated or a Europe of different speeds in the security and defense area. The question is, what does that mean in the security area if it comes to counterterrorism and so on and so on? There, the question of border management is essential to these things, where you can't simply drop out of it. Either you're in the Schengen area, and by that accept and actively contribute to protect the borders, or you're out. This is not an opt-in or opt-out as you can do it in operations.
Let me try a crass simplification. And it's this. The great advantage of alliances is that they save you, that they save every member energy, really. You know, you have a fixed arrangement. You have an agreement under what conditions you react, or at least have a conversation about reaction. You have a permanent forum of discussion of threats and challenges and risks. And it saves having to reorganize that every time you think something pops up. And over time, this permanent conversation creates a sense of familiarity with countries and partners who have very different risk perceptions. It has. If we hadn't had NATO, I don't want to think what Europe would have looked like today if we hadn't had NATO. I think that the enlargement of Europe is due in no insignificant degree to the Eastern Europeans wanting to join NATO before they joined the EU. Yeah? And therefore, I think that we are lucky to have it. But NATO's job has become more complicated at a time when we're talking more about long-term challenges that need to be managed than the actual risk or threat of military attack. Yeah? That's where the EU as a format becomes suddenly incredibly useful, because it has these fora, you know, where you can talk about the political, economic, and social aspects of these challenges. And in reality, we're lucky to have both. Yeah? And we're lucky that we have this very considerable overlap of both. Yeah? So that we have, throughout the Cold War and the 25 years thereafter, really gotten to know each other very well, yeah? Gotten to understand each other very well. We have a familiarity with each other that I think is very useful now. So I think that we're lucky that we don't have to be so flexible, you know, as flexible as we would have to be if these institutions didn't exist. That's something that we have to explain to people who are in high school now or who are in university now and who maybe haven't had the experience of living with these institutions. I mean, it's the same way, frankly, it's not so different from the current conversation we're having about representative and direct democracy. If you live in a world of everyday referenda, if any of you have ever lived in Sweden or in Switzerland or been there, and I have Swiss relatives, it's really hard work to familiarize yourself with all the political questions that the Swiss have to decide upon all the time. The great advantage of representative democracy is that you can delegate. You make a decision every 4 years, and because you have a system that guarantees political pluralism, you can know that somebody who fails to perform will be punished, and that you will be part of deciding on the punishment. So I think that flexibility may be necessary in some situations, but we should never go so far as to throw out our institutions, because they save us a lot of political energy, and they allow us to lead very peaceful lives and allow us to concentrate on other matters.
Constanze, thank you very much for that reminder. Thank you also, Christian, for all the thoughts and all your... I mean, you agreed in most part, but not on all. That was very...
Well, it would have been boring if we had agreed all the time, right?
Please join me in applause for our excellent speakers.